Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. This is Brother Ijaz Ahmed, and today I thought I would just do a really brief review of the it. And we might have a poor connection because it's actually raining really heavily in my country right now. So I'm hoping that the connection stays properly. Just going to wait maybe like 30 seconds again to see who shows up. And then I'll probably just continue with the review, inshallah, or begin in that case, really. All right, so Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, As-salatu was-salamu ala Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa barik wa salam tasliman kathiran. So I watched the hijab would debate in its entirety as the debate was going on. I've only had the opportunity to watch some of it again for a review a couple of days ago. So it hasn't been like I've been watching it over and over again. And so let me get off by saying, I think the debate was really exciting. The build up to it was really big. There was so much enthusiasm and excitement behind it. I would actually suggest before you watch the hijab would debate, that you actually watch the debate that Dr. Ali Atai had with David Wood. It was a couple of years ago, maybe 8 years ago, I think. But Dr. Ali Atai, he knows Greek, he knows Hebrew, he knows Arabic, he knows a bunch of languages, actually. He's a scholar as well. So I would actually suggest that you go watch his debate with David Wood before you watch the debate with Brother Muhammad Hijab. Now, when it came to the Muhammad Hijab debate, like I said, I found it to be very exciting. It was thrilling. But the debate wasn't really for me. Why? It was mostly polemics. If you watched the debate, you realize that both speakers spent most of their time arguing polemics as opposed to core doctrinal issues. And so I just wanted to, you know, go through it bit by bit. So in my mind, I'm trying to recollect from what I saw. I'm not looking at anything to remind me of the debate. The two opening statements, I think Brother Muhammad Hijab did excellently well. And I think when it came to David Wood's opening statement, I found quite a lot of problems with it. Primarily, his argument about the Quran, and we're going to get into his arguments about the Quran and Salah as it pertains to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll get into that. But his argument on the Quran, you actually need to know a bit of philosophy before you could understand what he was trying to argue in that opening statement. So if you watched the debate, David Wood, in arguing against Tawheed, says that there are narrations in which the Quran is supposed to come as a witness to your recitation and study of the Quran. So he's saying that the Quran comes alive, it's separate from Allah, maybe a different person from Allah, and that it testifies to Allah. So it's distinct from God in some sense, kind of like how the Trinity is one, but then there are three persons. And then I believe he referenced another narration on particular surahs of the Quran appearing as a witness for your recitation on the Day of Judgment. And so his argument was, Tawheed means one God but 114 persons. And so here's where the philosophy part comes in. In philosophy, primarily Greek philosophy, you have a being or a substance. And so any rational being, so they have free will, they can think, they are conscious, self-conscious, then they're also known as a person, right? So I am Ijaz Ahmed, my being is a rational being, therefore I become a person, or therefore I am a person, that's what you know me as. So here's the problem with David Wood's argument there. It's not the Quran coming alive on the Day of Judgment to testify to what your recitation was, it's actually your recitation of the Quran. So there's a distinction here, right? So in Islam, you have Kalamullah, which is the eternal speech of Allah, and then you have your lafad, or your speech from your tongue, what you utter by yourself. So for example, I say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alif Lam Mim. If I were to say that, those are my words coming out of my mouth. They exist in this created universe and on this created earth. So the distinction here is that my words or my voice is finite. It exists at a point in time, so it is temporal. And therefore, what I am reciting is created, but the eternal Quran, which is the word of Allah, is uncreated. So what appears on the Day of Judgment isn't the Quran as the Kalamullah, but my speech, what I recited from my tongue, right? So that's a distinction there. That's where David Wood got his argument wrong. Secondly, the argument on persons here. He is presuming either Platonic or Aristotelian ideas when it comes to the how a person is represented. So what we know of from the narrations, he actually got the narrations wrong in that sense. In those narrations, it does not teach us that the recitation, our recitation of the Quran, is a rational, distinct being. He didn't explain that point, and because he didn't explain that point, his logic is muddied, and therefore it can't be followed. He just claimed it's a person, but did not demonstrate how. What were his criteria for determining that a surah that's being recited is a person? He did not get into that, and there's a good reason for that, and I'll actually tell you why. It's because if he explained his reasoning, it's actually a hukum or a judgment against the Trinity, because it demonstrates that the Trinity is polytheism. And I'll give you an easy example of this. Again, in Greek philosophy, any rational being is a person or has personhood, the quality of personhood. Now, what we mean by rational here is that they're self-conscious, they can question their reality, they have free will. Are these the qualities that David applied to the recitation of the Quran? He didn't say. But we do know that in polytheism, if you worship more than one being, by definition, that's polytheism. And the Greek words that the Christians actually use for the Trinity, the ousia, or the substance of God. Substance is a synonym for the term being. So substance and being are synonyms. So when the Christians say that Christ has two natures, substances or beings, that means polytheism. Because if you have two natures, then you have two persons, because you have a nature. So you have a person per rational nature. And in addition to that, if you say that there are two natures and that there are two substances coexisting, then you end up with two beings, because nature, substance, essence, all these are synonyms for each other. So by definition, if you're a Trinitarian, you presume yourself to be polytheistic, because you believe in more than one being as God. And so you can look at the Nicene Creed. There's actually a book I would recommend. It's by Alcee Sproul. It's actually free on Kindle, on Amazon Kindle. It's called The Crucial Question Series, What is the Trinity? And he explicitly spells this out. We got our Trinity from Greek ideas. Now this guy, he recently passed away, I think last year or earlier this year, and he was a Calvinist conservative Christian. And so the reasoning that he uses in his book is that, yeah, we borrowed a lot from Greek philosophy. We did, as Christians, we did. And he actually says that nature, substance, being, these are all synonyms for each other. They mean the exact same thing. So this is why I believe David Wood, with his philosophy degree, didn't actually get into his reasoning as to why the lafad our recitation of the Quran, our creative recitation of the Quran, were persons. Because if he ascribed a personhood to them and he broke down the logic to reach that conclusion, it would instantly backfire on him. And had Brother Muhammad Hijab known this, and he mentioned this instantly, the polytheist label has to be applied to David Wood and most Trinitarian Christians. Again, nature is the same as being. It's synonyms of each other. So if you have two natures, then you have two beings, which gives us what? Polytheism. Because God is one being. Full stop. You'll actually read that God is indivisible. His substance, or his usia, is indivisible. Steve Pereira, thank you for your comment. You said that's a lie. If you're a father and you're a CEO, I'm not using analogies. Throw out the analogies. You're a Christian. Go back to what your doctrine teaches. Go back to the Council of Nicaea. Read the Nicene Creed, not the later one, the earlier one from 325 CE. Go down to the second to last or third to last line. It actually says hypostasis, kai ho, what's the word, usia. So it actually says in the Nicene Creed that they're synonyms for each other. So you worship two beings. So you automatically have polytheism inherent into your belief, not distinguishing it from polytheism. All right, so Steve asks, he's a Christian, by the way, he asks, what does it mean that the Quran will appear as a pale being? Okay, so Steve, we believe that the Quran is created, or a recitation of the Quran is created. So this is something, not a rational being, but it's something created by God to testify about what we used to do, given knowledge by God. That's it. So the problem with Christians is that they don't learn our terminology when it comes to ilm al-kalam, when it comes to our aqidah. So you don't study these terms. So when you read the word Quran, you can't distinguish between when it's referring to the eternal speech, which is kalam Allah, kalam nafsi, and you can't distinguish it between kalam lafsi. That's the problem with the Christian world. You don't actually know what Muslims believe about their Quran. You presume that you read the word Quran automatically means kalam Allah. We don't accept this, and you should know that. Right, moving on. What happened? Okay, I think there was at one point Brother Muhammad Hijab, he asked David Wood about Mark 13:32, and he actually focuses. I think I have the verse. Let me just see if I have the verse up here somewhere. I should have it up here somewhere. Mark 13:32. So I'm looking for Mark 13:32, and it says, "Concerning now the day that or the hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, if not for the Father." Okay, now Muhammad Hijab, he asked David Wood about the Holy Spirit here, not knowing the hour. David Wood spent about 3 minutes speaking about the Son not knowing the hour. The question was not, and I want you to notice this, it was not about the Son, it was about the Holy Spirit. And he even says that his understanding of this argument about Mark 13:32 was a bad argument. So he immediately rejects his own argument, but he never actually answered the question. Go back, wallahi, watch the clip. Muhammad Hijab asked him regarding Mark 13:32 about the Holy Spirit, and David Wood answers about the Son. That was never asked. So he doesn't actually answer the question, and there's a problem here. Let me tell you why. When it says, I may hope Patel, it means if not for the Father. Right, so it means that the angels, mankind, and Jesus don't know the date or time of the hour, if not for the Father. Now, most Christians will tell you that they believe in an economic trinity. It pertains to roles and not attributes or the core being of God. But the problem here is, this actually refers to being. Why does it refer to being? Because by definition, if you have a divine substance, then by definition, you're automatically all known as inherent within you. And so if your knowledge is conditional, then it's not eternal. If your knowledge is conditional, it's not inherent to you. And if you need permission to acquire that knowledge, then you're not God. So by definition, you have subordinationism here, which again, Christians will tell you is a heresy. But the term here, if not for the Father, the way that the church began to answer it is by saying, well, the Father did not give them permission to know about it. They knew about it, but he didn't give them permission to know about it. And the reason that they say this is because, again, if you read the verse in Greek, the very last four words, I me ho pater, which means if not for the Father. So it's conditional. But like I just explained, that is a problem because God's knowledge cannot be conditional. If he is all-knowing, by definition, he's all-knowing. His knowledge can't be conditional. If you understand that argument. But there's actually a bigger problem here to the equivalent verse in Matthew 24:36. This is what Matthew 24:36 reads. It says, "Concerning, however, the day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of the heavens, nor the Son, if not for the Father only." It adds the word monos. What is the problem here? Steve, I see your question. I will answer it. Let me just wrap up this point really quickly, if you don't mind, yeah? Because I will get to that as well. So in Matthew 24:36, it says, if not for the Father. So again, the Son and the Holy Spirit need permission from God to have knowledge that they should already have. That's one problem. But this verse adds another problem because it adds the word monos at the end. Now, monos means only. So only the Father knows this knowledge. So it's not about giving permission. It's about inherently having this knowledge before the permission is given. So this was actually a problem. And if you go to Codex Sinaiticus, I believe it's the earliest manuscript with Matthew 24:36, that's still intact. And you will actually see that the word monos has been taken out and added back in about three times, going all the way up to the 7th to 9th centuries CE. So long after the advent of early Islam, nascent Islam in Arabia, you had Christian scribes trying to change this verse to remove the word monos so that it harmonizes with Mark 13:32. But scribes kept adding it in and taking it out. Today it's in the translations, and what they say is they use the interpretation of Mark 13:32 and they ignore the word monos here. But when you do that, what do? You ignore the actual text as it reads, and it presents a severe doctrinal problem. And if you read any commentary, I suggest look up any Bible commentary on Matthew 24:36. If they don't mention that the word monos has been taken out and put back in various important manuscripts, early ones especially, then you're not reading a proper commentary. And if they don't speak about the issue associated with the word monos, again, they're trying to ignore a problem that is quite significant. Why would the scribes make the change if there wasn't a problem in the first place? Okay, so now Steve, a Christian, asked the question. Hijab also didn't answer the question, whom does Allah pray to? I understand he prayed for the Prophet, but whom did he pray to? So this refers to the Quran when it says, what's the thing? Inna Allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna 'alan nabi ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu 'alayhi wa sallimu taslima. When it says 'alan nabi, Allah, that means upon. He prays upon the Prophet, peace be upon him. So there's no prayer to. You don't see the word Allah there. You see the word Allah, but an ayn, right? So there's a difference in these words here. You cannot conflate praying upon and praying to. So I'll give you an example. If someone is sick and I pray upon them, it's different from praying to them. So if you're sick and I come by your bedside and I pray upon you, I'm invoking something good upon you. But if I'm praying to you, this is a difference of prepositions. If I pray to you, then I'm worshiping you. So there's a distinction here automatically. If you don't know the Arabic language, it becomes a problem. The word prayer, I have no problem with it, because this is called a relational verb. So when it says sallu ala nabi, pray upon the Prophet, it means that Allah invokes his blessings upon the Prophet. That's what the verse means. So there's a difference between praying to and praying upon. And in the English, I can understand if you're confused by it, but it doesn't actually answer the question in the first place. So I'll give you another example. If I say the love of God, and then I say the love of Ijaz, the love that we're speaking of are two distinct things, because the love of God is greater than anything I can give, and my love is very limited. But if you read in the Bible, for example, that God loves the world, are you going to equate his form of love with my form of love? You're not. So that's what we call a false equivalency. You try to apply two things and make them equal when they're not. And that is improper hermeneutics. Now, I believe that David, well, that's not what, so Steve says, but that's not what the Arabic translation says. Yeah, the Arabic translation says, Sallu ala nabi. Look up the word Allah. Ayn, lam, ya. Just look it up and you'll see it, Steve. And by the way, the Arabic translation in English, it's called an interpretation. So it's a de facto interpretation, kind of like the word proskuneo. When I use that word, does it mean lick like dog, kiss hands like a dog would kiss a master's hand? Or does it mean worship? Or does it mean reverence or obeisance? Right? So it doesn't matter what the English says. You have to go back to what the Arabic says. And then you have to interpret the English in light of the Arabic. And if you don't know what a relational verb is, I strongly recommend you go and learn about relational verbs. I actually give you an easy example that you Christians might understand. When you say God died upon the cross, you're referring to his human nature, not his divine nature, because the divine nature cannot die. You accept that. So you accept that the word die, which is a verb, is a relational verb as it applies to God. There's a difference between the word when it is applied to man and when it is applied to God. It's basic. So it answers your question. Doesn't matter what Christian prince does, because that individual is a coward who would not actually debate on stage. We have offered him it many times. Moderated debate, we'll hire security, inshallah. It could just be a room with 10 people, for goodness sake. Come on stage, show what you have. And I would actually recommend that you go to what ask Christian prince one question. Why doesn't he go to the Arabic debate rooms with these questions? Why does he stay in the English? It is because about 6 or 7 years ago, he used to be active on the in the Arabic rooms, and he would bring these arguments, and he would be laughed out, immediately laughed out. So he'd go into the English, and most Christians and Muslims don't speak the Arabic language, so he's appealing to an audience that's inherently ignorant. And I think that's inherently dishonest on his behalf. So I hope I answered your question, Steve, and thank you for your kind comment. I'm trying to be as helpful as I can. And here's what, Steve, you can inbox us at any time, and I will answer your question with references. With references, okay? So moving on. So I spoke about the opening statements. I spoke about the crossfire. I spoke about Mark 13:32. I spoke about persons, the Quran being persons. I spoke about the Quran being created. What else did I miss in the debate? There's actually one argument I suggested that Brother Muhammad Hijab should have used in that debate, which he did not use. Had he used it, there was no way for David Wood to walk that back. The argument is, where does the New Testament delimit the number of persons in the Godhead? It doesn't. There's no single one verse that says three only. Tres monos. Three only. So if I go to example, so I'll give you a quick example. When you read the New Testament, oftentimes you'll see in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And as a Christian, you read that and you say, oh, Trinity is mentioned in these verses. But this is referred to as a doxology, doxology. So a doxology was something that usually said at the end of a prayer or at the beginning of a prayer. And so what happened is that most New Testament scholars agree the doxologies were added in over a period of time due to liturgical use. So the doxologies that we read today, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, weren't there originally. That's a significant point. And I would actually recommend Philip Comfort's book, Encountering the Manuscripts, where he mentions this point specifically. He's a conservative Christian. He says it's added in. I'm going to take his word for it. He's not the only one to say so, though. You look at any transcription of the and collation of the New Testament uncials, and you'll actually see that they tell you it's mostly added in. The only place that the dispute is added is in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, in the verse of the Great Commission. But that verse, the earliest attestation I know of it, again, is in Codex Vaticanus and Codex Sinaiticus, which are from the 4th century. So it's not as if it goes back to the time of Paul, or goes back to the time of Christ, or goes back to the time of the disciples. You're at least 300 centuries away, so I would disregard that entirely. Right, so I was saying, there's no passage in the Old or New Testament that delimits the number of persons in the Godhead to three. There's my fingers, there we go, three. There's no place where this is done. So how many persons are there in the Godhead? We don't know. There can actually be more, much, much more. And so the only counter argument I believe I received on this was, again, the use of the doxologies in the name of the Father and Son and the Holy Spirit. I explained that these were interpolations added over time due to liturgical use. So I removed that counter argument, and so far I haven't gotten any meaningful responses to that. Listen to me. You go into the Quran, I know we actually have to go into what Anthony Rogers said, that dimwit. Let me get into what he says. So we've transitioned. The New Testament and the Old Testament don't delimit the number of persons in the Godhead to three. So God could be 1,000 persons. 1,000. Doesn't change anything for the Christians. But the Quran, it's different. In the Quran, it is different. Because we say, Qul huwallahu ahad. Say he's Allah, the only one, absolute one, full stop. So number of persons, one. Number of beings, one. Number of gods, one. Full stop. The verse explains it. But the Christians did make a mistake. So I released an article by Brother Sharif Randauer. He actually co-wrote a book with Numan Ali Khan from Bayana. They worked together, actually. And they studied together, mashallah, brilliant individual. He answered that he actually got it wrong. Now, what Anthony Rogers did was a bit embarrassing. In the first video he did with Vocab Malone, that's like immediately after the debate the same night, he says that Muslims recited the Quran wrong because at the end of the surah, sorry, at the end of the ayah, ayah 1, it says ahadun in the Arabic, but Hijab and the crowd said in unison ahad. So why didn't they say ahadun? Sorry about that, that was Adobe Creative Cloud. Why didn't they say ahadun? This is the problem when you don't know tajweed. When you come to a waqf, or when you come to a stop or a rest in place, the haraka the vowels are removed and it takes on a sukun. So you stop. It becomes a resting letter, not a moving letter with movements. So for example, when you look at the basmala, if I could note the basmala really quickly, so that's Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Let me go to a website really quick with the Quran 1:1. I'll read that really quickly, so don't give me 1 sec. Right. So the basmala says Rahimi, but we don't say Rahimi when we finish the end of the basmala. Right? We say Rahim because the haraka, the kasra is removed and it's replaced with a sukun. So you say Rahim and you stop. So one, when you make that argument that Anthony Rogers made, it's a bad argument because it shows that you don't know the basics of reciting the Quran. It shows that you don't actually know how to understand or read the Quran. So it's more of an embarrassment for him than it is a valid criticism of Islam. Secondly, he says it should mean one off, and we've dealt with this in the article by Brother Sharif. No, it does not mean one off. It means one, full stop. He actually didn't go into any citations or references for it meaning one off when it says ahadun. He just blurted it out without any references. And you have to remember, this is the same guy that was humiliated by myself in my first debate with him, and also humiliated by Dr. Anthony Buzzard on Psalm 110, chapter 1. The Lord said to my Lord, he was trying to read the Hebrew, he got it wrong. He insisted, he mocked Dr. Buzzard. Dr. Buzzard told him, pull it up, check it again. Turns out that Dr. Buzzard was right all along, and Anthony was just horribly incorrect. So subhanAllah, he's been humiliated in the past. And I think what's going on right now is that they're trying to do damage control. So I've explained the Ahadun argument, I've explained the Salah argument. It's all been dealt with. You will realize that nothing new was introduced into this debate by the Christian side. Nothing new, at least nothing intelligible and new at the same time. But Brother Muhammad Hijab did use an argument, I believe, that was initially used by Brother Adnan Rashid, Ustad Adnan Rashid. And in this claim, it's that no church father presents the Trinity in their writings within the first 300 years of Christianity in the same way that Christians today believe in the Trinity. And so after the debate, David and a couple of his friends were posting quotes from the church fathers. And it was a bit hilarious. Let me explain to you why it was hilarious. They were appealing to these early church fathers, speaking about the Trinity, but not a single manuscript exists from the first 300 years from these church fathers. They claim speak about the Trinity. Almost every single one of them is from the 6th and 8th century onwards. And many scholars have said that the Nicene Creed was interpolated, the Chalcedonian Creed was interpolated into these texts. So we don't actually have the originals, we don't have copies of the originals, we don't have copies of the copies of the copies of the originals when it comes to the patristic writings. And you can look at the, I believe it's the Tres Megistros, if I got that really big name. So it's Tres Megistros, or it's called the LDAB database. I think it's Leverkusen Digital something something. I forgot the actual name for it. But at the LDAB database, you can search for any church father, and look for the earliest manuscript that mentions when their earliest writing is from. So the Christians are appealing to something that is not concurrent to the first 300 years. So one, they didn't actually understand the point that Brother Muhammad Hijab was making. Two, because he didn't actually understand the point, they're trying to go back now and dig up references that we know are interpolations. So they're actually appealing to fake news, legitimate fake news at this point. So I'm not sure how long I've been speaking for. I only actually intended to do a quick review of the debate. I don't have anything new to add except for what I spoke about Mark 13, 32, Matthew 24, 36. Other than this, I think the debate was mostly polemical based. I don't think David prepared for the debate, or at least his arrogance got to him and he didn't prepare as he should have. I think he was given the argument on the Quran being persons by Shimon. And let me tell you, it's such a bad argument that Muslims instantly disregarded it. And because it was so poorly taught out, no one is using it. You've realized, no, they've discarded that argument. They've gone on to the word Salah as it pertains to Allah and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But this has been dealt with for centuries. Word equivalences, if word equivalences at the best that they can do, then they have effectively lost the debate, right? So I would actually, on this page, the Calling Christians page, we actually have an article by another article, a video with David Wood and Brother Radush Shubuhato Akil dialoguing with David Wood after the debate. And he asks him, has God's nature been changed? Has the person of God been changed by taking on a new nature? David Wood could not answer. If you've done a first year seminary class, or if you go to a weekly Bible study, wallahi, you should be able to answer that with your eyes closed. David was unable to do so. I'm not sure why. He's very weak in his own akida. I'll tell you that right now. That's pretty much all I wanted to say today. Unless you have any questions in the comment section. So guys, I'm looking at the comment section. If you have any questions, I'll give you about a minute to type them up. And if not, I'll just close off the live stream, inshallah. Drinking some Coca-Cola, alhamdulillah, you know. Wearing my Chelsea t-shirt. There we go. The only club in London to win the Champions League. Right, just waiting to see if you have any questions in the comment section. I would also, this Carlton individual is a Christian, I would actually suggest that you don't use foul language on my page, please. This is not a church. Don't use words like that here, please. All right, guys, so it does not seem as if there are any new questions that I haven't answered already. So I'm going to close off here. Thank you for watching, inshallah. And we do have some exciting news upcoming very soon about some live events. I'll let you know the dates and the times. Still figuring out some of the times, but I'll let you know, inshallah. Thank you for watching. Assalamu alaikum. And I hope you check out the debate and follow up on the information after the debate. It's very important. Assalamu alaikum.